Hello everyone, my name is Chris, and I'm representing Team Test, and we have developed a novel biosensor that is able to detect adalimumab directly in blood plasma using a one-steps bioluminescent assay. We're using two capture molecules that are able to specifically bind to adalimumab in solution. First, we're using TNF-alpha, the original target of adalimumab. And then we're using a second capture molecule called, which specifically binds to the adalimumab TNF-alpha complex, using the second capture molecule adds even more specificity of our assay to our analyte. This will lead to the formation of this heterotrimeric complex consisting out of adalimumab, TNF-alpha, and the antibody that is specific to this complex. And we can generate the light signal by combining this complex with a unique enzyme called nanobit. This consists out of two elements, small bits and large bits, and we can attach those to our sensor proteins. So through the formation of this heterotrimeric complex, small bit and large bit are able to come together to form a complete nanobit enzyme, which is a blue bioluminescent enzyme which emits blue light by oxidizing its substrate. So how have we obtained these unique sensor proteins? We have designed a DNA sequence containing monomeric TNF-alpha and small bit, and we have successfully expressed this protein in E. coli. We've also managed to let it form functional trimers in solution. We have obtained large bit with our antibody by expressing large bit with protein G, an immunoglobulin binding protein. And this binds to our antibody, to the CH2-CH3 junction. However, we can make it form a covalent bond with our antibody by exposing it to UV light, which will lead to stable and active antibody conjugates. But we can go even further, as one of the dangers of using bioluminescent assays is that your signal is not only proportional to your analyte concentration, it is also affected by several other experimental factors, such as pH, temperature, substrate concentration, which can all affect the intensity of your signal. However, we can correct for those by adding a second compound called Nanoleuk M neon green, which is a variant of this nanobit enzyme, which uses the same substrate and is also affected by the same experimental conditions. So by taking the ratio of blue and green light, we obtain a very robust measure of the adalimumab concentration, as this ratio will remain constant regardless of the experimental conditions that your experiment, that your assay is in. And how is it going to look like in our biosensor? We can pipette our sensor proteins with our sample, our blood sample, in a cartridge. And this is inserted in our biosensor. This will emit both blue and green light, which can be split by the use of a dichroic mirror into two separate light channels. And you can see here on the right that when we increase the adalimumab concentration, we get an increase in blue light. And this is also reflected back in our dose response curve, where we can plot the ratio of blue and green light as function of the adalimumab concentration. Where you can see when we have low adalimumab, you only see green light. And when we increase the concentration, we get an increasing blue light signal. So to conclude, we have developed a method that is able to directly measure adalimumab in blood plasma. We have a very robust measure of the concentration, as this will remain as the ratio will remain constant regardless of the experimental conditions that your assay is in. We have obtained very high sensitivity and precision both off-chip in a plate reader and on-chip with our biosensor. Our sample volume is only 7 microliters, and our time to result is within 5 minutes. Thank you for listening.
So thank you very much. So who has a question? Yes.
So, thank you very much for this nice presentation. Actually, to me, it's not really clear. I'm coming from a very technical background.
Yeah.
So, it seems your sensor is performing the best by far.
Yeah, so apparently, yeah.
In the live results.
So. Yeah.
But how much development was then done by the team on the biochemical side? You said you expressed something in E. coli.
But this TNF-alpha protein, we designed it ourselves. So the thing about TNF-alpha is that we found in literature that it was really difficult to express by multiple groups as the protein, if it was incorrectly folded, it would aggregate, it would form clumps, and it would be basically unable to be used in an assay. So we had to dig into the literature And we found an article that is able to correctly express this protein using a certain tag, a sumo tag, which basically resulted in a high yield of this protein and correct folding of this protein with and the formation of these functional trimers. Okay. So yeah, so we used that sequence, and then we had to add a linker. You see, yeah, I didn't mention it, but the gray line over there is the glycine serine linker, which enables SmallBit, or which gives SmallBit enough conformational freedom to form a complex with LargeBit.
Okay, because I see SmallBit, LargeBit. This is something you can really purchase. There, start.
Yeah, NanoBit is actually purchasable from Promega, so okay. It's commercially available. And the antibody that we use is also commercially available.
But the biochemical assay itself was then designed by for your team.
Yes.
Okay. Good. So thank you very much for your presentation. There's one thing I would like clarification. So how do you prevent from small bit forming with large bit in solution?
It's impossible, basically. But the affinity of large bit and small bit is so low that it's barely... Well, the most activity that comes, or the most background signal, you would think that it would be from large bit and small bit forming solution, but it's actually only from large bit that's able to oxidize the substrate, not as efficiently as, I don't have the blank line here, but it's not as efficient as nanobit, but most of the background signal only comes from large bit and not from freely formed nanobit complexes.
Thank you for a very nice presentation, very clear. A few questions. Yeah. So your optical readout was based on interference? Or was
No, it's basically just blue and green light. So our sample will emit both blue and green light due to the fact that, due to nanobit and amnion green, which, emit both blue and green light. And this is split by the Krug mirror. And it's not interference. I can understand it's a little bit confusing, but basically, but like the blue light is sent to one photodiode, the green light is sent to the other one.
Okay, so use two photodiodes, two separate photodiodes.
Yes, and we then have two separate light channels in which we only measure voltage that is generated due to blue or green light.
And did you build this yourself?
Sorry?
Did you build this yourself?
With the photodiodes? No,
not the photo, the setup with the photodiodes and the screen.
Yeah, we used an optical cage where we placed our lenses, our Krug mirrors, and our photodiodes. Okay. Yeah.
Good. And just again, I'm always curious about the sample preparation.
Yeah.
A pre-preparation?
A pre-preparation, yeah, of course. So what we're doing now is that we have, we mix our components, so our sense proteins, our TNF-alpha, our antibody, and our amnion green. We mix them together before an experiment. And then we grab like 21 microliters of this, and we add this to 7 microliters of our blood plasma sample, which is mixed. And after an incubation time of like 3 minutes, we add our substrates, generating light. And then we can put it in our sensor and measure a signal.
Right. And so you have to do this before the experiment.
Yes, and if we want to do, we've performed experiments with drying in our sensor proteins in our cartridge. Since then, if you want to use for a point of care setting, you'd only need a blood prick, and put your blood in the sample. This blood will dilute your sensor proteins that are present in the chip.
Yeah.
And basically just doing the same thing as we're doing now.
Right. So that's what you want.
But in the chip, eventually we want to go over there, yeah.
Yeah, that's great. And do you know about this chemistry that you have developed? Is that, can you store that at room temperature, or how robust is that?
We can incubate our samples at room temperature and then it's still stable, yeah. But most experiments we've performed them on ice just to be sure.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Maybe not from the jury, but from... okay, sorry, I didn't see that.
So then I have another one. Yeah. The reader you designed, that is nice engineering, but could you also transfer the biochemical assay you did on standard readers of other companies?
Yes, we first performed them in a plate reader. There's a picture over here, that one. We just... yeah, pipetted our samples with our sensor proteins, and we measured them in a plate reader. And what you see here on top is actually a photo made from a plate reader with a over from a well plate with a digital camera.
Okay.
So these are like actual samples that we measured in a plate reader that you can see here on top.
Okay, because you
we first want to validate if it works in a plate reader, of course, and that would be the best thing since we then can also see the spectrum of our proteins and optimize based on that data.
Yeah, you also discussed the optional market entry that you want to give free tools to the clinics and so on. But there's another business model that you offer this to companies, you know, already having these kind of readers.
Yeah.
So if this works.